Our next speaker goes by the name of Mark Parker. He's actually a social entrepreneur. He's currently studying for his PhD. You'll be pleased to know that.
I am pleased to know that.
And he actually has a master's degree already, so he's a bit of a boffin. I don't know if anyone under the age of 60 uses the word boffin anymore, but I guess I just did. I'm old. He's the CEO and founder of Jamix, which is a cloud and mobile customer support company. He's also a trustee at Mixit Reach. And he's got a quite interesting talk title, which Maria, I think you're going to enjoy. Please welcome Mr. Marlon Parker with his talk, Breaking Bad.
Thank you. So as you heard, welcome to the opening session for the after party. So I've got an honor and just seeming to have the popcorn now. Now I'm not going to talk about chemistry, nor am I going to talk about math either. But I do think that, or salt and vinegar for that matter, which is even worse than meth. But basically what I think, although we're talking about WordPress and we're talking about, you know, sliders and technology and all those kind of things, where I'm from, there is still, unfortunately, a reality that we still find people that are still suffering, people that are still going through all kinds of challenges, a lot of social ills that our communities and our society is going through. Now, I'm not the boffin. Just give you a quick how I was introduced to the whole world of technology. After finishing school, I had no clue what I wanted to do. So I was pushing trolleys at the airport for about 2 years, basically living off tips. And then I always had this life ambition that I wanted to wear a shirt and a tie one day, because from where I grew up and the place where I'm from, if you wear a shirt and a tie, Chris, then you've arrived. You know, so there was a job opening and I could basically go into, it was a filing job in the office, and I thought, wow, you know, I'm going to be the first person in my family ever to wear a shirt and a tie when we go to work. That's a massive achievement. And plus, I knew the lady that was doing the interviews as well. So I thought, clearly, this job is done and dusted. I'm going to get this job. My dream is going to come true. And I even went to go and buy me a little leather, red sachet, which is not real leather, you know. Couldn't afford that. And I could practice, and I could really see myself walking over the field in my shirt and my tie. And the neighbors would look and say, oh, wow, there Martin is going. You know, he has arrived. And lo and behold, I never got the job. And I was heartbroken. But I made a promise that I'm going to go and study once I'm done, when I leave this pushing on the trolley job. Eventually, the first person I walked into came up to me and says, Marlon, you know, what are you doing? And I said, no, I'm going to go and study because I'm finished with this pushing on the trolley. I need to do something better. And the person says, so what are you going to go and study? And I said, I've got no idea. But I need to go and study. I saved up $100 at the time, on 2 years, enough to pay an application fee. To go and do something. And this person said, Marlon, you must go and do it. I'm like, it? Like, what is it? She said, no, man, it. You must go and study it. Now, this person is working in a restaurant. And I said, but now, what is it? She said, no, it's information technology. I'm like, so what is that? I've got no idea. I was helping these people at the table, and they were talking about it all the time. So you must do it. And that was my career guidance that got me into technology. So with that advice, and I came to the realization that in my community there's still a lot of people that are suffering. As much as the world is evolving and everybody is leveraging the power of technology, we still have people that are dying. People that are still living in poverty. And for me it's all about how do we go about, with all the people in this room, with all our expertise, how do we go about breaking the bad? And through that I'm going to share a little story of RLabs, which stands for Reconstructed Living Lab, which was founded in this beautiful place called Cape Town, right? Beautiful beaches, I'm sure you've seen some of the beauty, I guess from the US. But there's also another reality. We do have our townships and a place where I grew up on, which is called the Cape Flats. And that is actually where RLabs started. Now, it's also the place that was where we had the American gang was started there, the Americans. You can see the flag, yeah? And that is the home of the American gang, which is the largest and the most notorious gang in Southern Africa. And for us, it was all about how do we begin in this community to begin about using technology to bring about change. Even though a lot of people have given up, and even though we see young people walking around who just given up on hope. And the one thing we realized was not about technology. It was not about, oh, okay, you must become an entrepreneur or you must go and finish school. It was heartbreaking to see young kids at the age of 9 and 10 who left school, who want to leave school, starting to push drugs purely because there's no family figure or no father or mother figure in their lives. And the one thing we realized it was missing in our communities was this thing called hope. And you can see when someone has lost hope. You can look into their eyes and you can see that they've lost hope. You can, it doesn't matter what you're wearing. Even if you've got a cool work camp t-shirt, your eyes are not going to lie, right? And that is where we started. It was purely at the end of 2007 when I'm walking in my community, I realized that how do I begin to get people to start sharing stories of hope again? And that then brought me into the whole thing about using blogs. Now, at the time, we didn't have any funding. There was no business plan or major strategy. It was really just about meeting a real need in the community where I grew up on. And this is really what we had. We started with a 386 computer. Back then, the computers used to have numbers for names. Right? And it was running on dial-up. So the first thing I did, there was a guy whose father was the founder of the American Gang. Right? And he really just wanted to, it was all about him sharing his story. And by doing that, I then introduced him to, for him to start blogging. We then showed him YouTube videos. Now you can imagine watching a YouTube video on a dial-up connection. You just see that little circle going all the time. There was no RSA way back then to help us with fast internet. Right? And up until today, some of the early guys that was in the classes coming to learn about social media, whenever you have a video camera in front of them, their head still goes. Because of the whole kind of YouTube kind of thing, right? So started with that. This guy started blogging and he started showing his friends, listen, this is what I wrote. And they were amazed because he was now on the internet, even though they didn't understand what the internet was. After that, we had about 14 of them who came along, and this was a photo of some of them. And they then came and they said, Marlon, we also want to learn how to do this internet thing, the social media thing. And this first group of guys that we managed to get were very bad. I mean, they didn't have any CVs, but they had impressive criminal records, some of them. So for example, one of the guys there was the most wanted for organized crime. The other one was the first crystal meth dealer in the community, better known as Stuck for us on the Cape Flats. The other one, he was actually a hitman, not for real, like a real hitman, right? I thought it was only the movies. So these guys were pretty bad, really, really bad. But the one thing they had, they came into a time in their lives where they really just wanted to make a change. And they wanted to do something that would add value into their communities. So I had to go to my university, which I was working at the time. I then had to ask them, can I please utilize your computer lab at only 2 Saturday mornings in a month. That's all I want. So my boss at the time wanted to know, now who are these community people that's going to come? I said, how am I going to tell this lady that, you know? And I said, those community members who want to learn. You know, they want to learn. I couldn't tell those ex-gang members, ex-drug dealers. But eventually I had to now confess. I said, no, you know, they are ex-gang members, they're ex-drug dealers. Some of them were wanted for organized crime. And her eyes went open like that. So then she said, okay, can I come and visit one of your sessions? I said, no, sure, you can come and visit. And that day, and also because it was about 20 kilometers and I only had one car, I had to make 3 trips to drop them at the location. And the security guard didn't want them to come in, they had to wait outside. So only when I'm there, they were allowed to come in. And so my ex-boss came and I remember, she didn't want to come into the class. She was standing by the door and said, no, it's okay. You go on with the class. You know, and then she went on and basically, I remember asking the question, like, what did anybody know anything about computers? Which I thought was a good place to start. And the one guy with all the tattoos and the bullet wounds got up and she said, ah, Marlon. You know, of course his pants was hanging down here. Because we know lots about computers, you know? We know how to steal them. And now this was in front of this boss, and I thought that wasn't a very good start. Right? So immediately I changed the topic and said, have anybody ever heard about Windows? He said, yeah, that is what we break into to steal the computers. So that is where we started. No knowledge, but we then began getting them onto sharing these stories. Number one, using blogs. And it was really challenging in the beginning. I mean, there was some of them haven't been to school for a very long time. So when they write the blog post, you can imagine, it was just lots of red all over. And they got very frustrated. Then they started bringing dictionaries with them to class. And then they realized, oh, they can actually change the spelling online. And they started learning and just sharing their stories. But through all of this, we also find that many of them started saying things such as, you know, Marlon, before, whenever people used to see our names anywhere on the graffiti, there was always a bad connotation next to their name. But now when people start reading their stories, it had something positive to do. And although they started their blog, we called the blog at the time The Reconstructed. They won an award, one of the blogging awards, but also we also wrote a little academic paper, because that was still was my days of academia, about how by them using blogging for them to share their stories, it was actually also very therapeutic for them, which was very incredible. But then after a while, we had a big problem. We then had some of the mothers in the community that came and said, but we also have stories to share. What about our stories? And they then said, can't we also start something? And that is when we then launched the Mom 2.0 project, based on the Web 2.0 thing, of course, and the Geeky Moms. And we then introduced them to how they can start using blogs, sharing their stories, because they had children that was going through the same thing. And we actually used the same young men that used to disempower these women in the community. They started empowering them on actually how to share their stories. And we had a very popular blog that we had, of course, was our Geeky Moms blog. And our oldest graduate that we had was 92 years old. And that happened because one of the day that one granny introduced her to Google, and I mean, they were very impressed. Because you now tell them something, and all of a sudden something happens in front of them. It's a big thing. But then we told them that they can go and Google recipes, you know, and so she was Googling an apple tart, and when she saw the recipe, she got up, and she says, no man, the internet is wrong. Now the one thing I've learned is you never ever argue with a 92-year-old granny. If she tells you the internet is wrong, then it's wrong. So of course we took that opportunity to introduce it to blogging, right? And one of our grannies, actually a 78-year-old, who's now one of our co-facilitators at Arn Labs, Google actually invited her to come and speak about how she uses Google Apps. And her 8-year-old husband got upset because she's now on Facebook and talking with all her grandchildren and the great-grandkids. That he's now attending the class and she's the facilitator, right? And this is what they're doing in the 80s. But all of a sudden, we started seeing how people were sharing stories about them. And they then started using their mobile phones, because there was, of course, no computers and stuff. So we had to find creative ways of how they can actually blog onto WordPress that would not cost them a lot of money. Because unfortunately, accessing back then, 2008, accessing WordPress via your mobile device wasn't a very friendly thing. We're talking about a feature phone. So at that time, we literally kind of hacked into Mixit, and we did something that meant that they can blog a post that would cost them one South African cent. So they loved it, so they started sharing community stories through their mobile devices. And then after that, we then of course had the little children that came along and said, but we also want to share stories. So all of a sudden, we had a number of our community members, four different generations, that was coming together using blogging as a way for them to share stories. And what we began to see, we actually started seeing change happening. That people's lives started changing. All of a sudden, when we had the program with the kiddies, the moms would be there, and they would just be there to call themselves the huggers. Not even make the sandwiches, they're just there to embrace the little ones. Because many of these kids don't have any parents at home. And this was something that began to change the way we do things. After a while, this then led into what we call the Arn Labs Academy. And since doing the academy, we've trained more than 80,000 people on various things, such as around technology, to entrepreneurship, to photography. Photography is very popular. Man, people love taking photos of themselves in the bathroom. And they always leave the flash on for some weird reason. No idea why. But they started using a play and learn approach to learning. And so the community members themselves used what they understood about, for example, about WordPress, and they started coming up with creative ways of how they can actually teach that to their community members. And of course, they do some funny stuff like the funky chicken. Here they started introducing them to the power of the internet. And now these are the moms, the geeky mom class, right? This is a class about the internet, seeing how you can become connected with one another, and they had to come dressed up as a superhero. So this one mom, she was Spider-Man. So that's why she was climbing the tree. Here we were teaching them WordPress, and we showed them about, for many of them, the concept of that you're now going to have a home page, like a place that you can call home. And they actually use creative ways of how they can build what their home should look like. Before they even start touching the computers, it's all about what they want to feel when they believe that this is their home. And for many of them, they can start, even though they might not have it in their real life setting, they could actually build an ideal home situation for them virtually, which is quite a lot of fun. And some of the other programs that we do is like the Grow Leadership Academy. And I know we have some of our guys and graduates that's right at the back there. Can you give a wave at the back? There they are. And they were young people in the age of 18 and 25. Thank you very much. We started learning how to use, how they can actually leverage the power of WordPress and other technologies to not just to equip and empower themselves, but how they could use it to make a difference in the communities. And Wuthin is one of our partners there, where they just do amazing work running these kind of digital boot camps. And of course, if any of you are interested, please do have a chat with you afterwards. So through all of this, we realize we're equipping and empowering people, which is amazing. But the one thing that we realize, and I think Chris touched on it early on, and it's something for you to remember, is that it's always the best people that understand the problem that they're going through are the people who actually live in these circumstances. Who best understand what poverty is about than someone who lives? That's a day-to-day situation. So with all of these challenges that people were facing, and now they are equipped and empowered, these people are actually becoming the problem experts. And if you become a problem expert, then it's much easier for you to actually solve a problem. And that was one of the key lessons that we started to learn. So some of the people then came up with creative ideas of how they could use WordPress and actually make a difference in their communities. Now I'll just give you some examples quickly. Now one of the examples was this blog called Bari Vioni, which was done by a young man. He came into a one-day WordPress workshop in Tanzania. He's an orphan boy. He's getting himself through university by cutting wood weekends and selling wood. And that is basically what he does, just to make a living so that he can survive. And then he realized that there's no student community at all in Tanzania online. And he had this great after sitting and seeing the power of WordPress. He said, why doesn't he create a place where students, like our old student village and all these other websites that we have, why can't he create something like that for the guys in Tanzania? And he started doing this 10 months ago. I mean, with his little minimal knowledge that he had, he built up the blog. And now 10 months later, he's got something like over 40,000 people that's liking their Facebook page and regular subscriptions. People that subscribe to his blog. 10 months and 40,000 subscribers, that's pretty neat for someone that sat in a one-day WordPress workshop with no skills at all in design or anything. He literally just used the power of the platform to do something, right? Another one, and the guys at the back there, Nathaniel, saw the thing about that there's young people in our communities that's struggling to find a place where they can be empowered and equipped, especially around the things such as leadership and how do you make hope contagious. So he again also used WordPress to make a difference in the community, to allow these young people to engage with one another and sharing their stories as well. And another example, the young lady who started this also at the back, called What's Your Price? It was all about how did you actually begin. A lot of people buy consumer goods, and it was an opportunity for people to actually start pricing what they are paying for consumer goods, and we started mapping it. So that you can see, am I actually paying a fair price for this loaf of bread? Am I overpaying it? Why am I paying so much money if I'm inland for fish compared to when I'm living on the coast? And this was an opportunity for people to learn why certain things are being spent around consumer goods. And they were all using the power of WordPress to do this, right? Another popular one, which is a story of She's the Geek, which is a technology blog, but also it's a community around, especially working with women and empowering them around the power and the use of technology. Now the girl that started this, when she started with our classes, she was an ex-drug addict, tough life, you know, and she really just kind of had a passion for technology. And she was writing and showing women, and why do they have to, when they read a tech review, why can't you have a tech review from the base of a woman? Right? Why can't you have a different viewpoint? People that generally, because those are the people in all honesty that write all the reviews or all the experts. You know, so they were trying to say, why can't an ordinary housewife actually write a review about a product? And they are now doing work for the Samsungs and all the other brands of the world. And it's people from the community, from the township and the Cape Flats, that's actually writing reviews about products for these big brands. And they built a huge community around this, also working with people from that's been, for example, has been involved in prostitution, or people that come from safe houses, teaching them how they can use the power of storytelling to begin to change their lives. But a big one for us, which really, I believe, did a lot of things for our labs as such, was when we found that there was a big problem with the drug problem that they had in South Africa, especially in Cape Town. We needed to come up with an idea of how we can provide people access to counseling services. These were people that had drug addictions, and unfortunately government said there was a 6 to 12 month waiting period for anybody that wanted access to a rehabilitation center. This is now 2008. Now because we had the problem experts with us, the people we used to sell the drugs, we used to use them and all of those kind of things. And they said, well, why can't we provide people with counseling services via their mobile phones? That's a very simple idea. So back then we started using the Mixit platform, which was very popular, but you know. And we then started providing them, people in our community, with access to counseling services. First went to a local school and we went to a principal, saying, give us your 10 worst kids so we can see if they would actually want to chat with us. Back then there was no platform built. It was literally just using what was there. The principal wanted to give us off the school. We negotiated to come down to 20 so that we can at least see if it's going to work, because we don't know if it's going to help or not. Right? Again, coming back to the thing that Adi was saying earlier about your MVP. And a week later, we had 50 kids talking to us. And after a while, because the numbers were growing, hundreds of kids were chatting to us around their problems with either a family member or they themselves that's got a problem with drug addiction. So then we realized we actually needed to build a platform that will allow us to manage these conversations. And again, we started mixing up another platform and we plugged into WordPress, which allowed us to actually build a little system that manages conversations that people are having through accessing counseling services. And I'll tell you a little bit more about this later on. But the one thing that WordPress did for our community, it actually allowed people to become social innovators. Ordinary people from our communities didn't need to become experts, right? They understood the problem. They were problem experts, but they could actually do something that will bring real meaning into their communities, which I think was so powerful. But then something else happened, unfortunately. We then realized that some of these ideas that people were coming up with could actually become social, could actually become little enterprises. And I'm going to give you a few examples of how we can actually turn some of these ideas into businesses. So that little mobile counseling service that we built, we eventually became Jamix. And today we've serviced more than 4 million users through a platform that was built right there on the Cape Flats. Had over 1.5 billion messages. And the first version of the technology we had, the front end was WordPress, and the back end we basically built our own technology that allows us to kind of work with all kind of messaging systems. So to allow people to plug into Mixer, to Google Chat, before BBM had a bit of problem, into BBM. And this was a technology that we built that was serving a real need in our communities. Not just around, was it used in South Africa, the same technology then got exported to Europe, to Asia, and to other countries. And our first version of the technology was literally just a little bit of a MVP, and WordPress was the front end, right? Another example And these were all technologies that we built out of the ideas that the community members had. Was called Cinemo. Now, before Cinemo went, now Cinemo was in our incubator, so another thing, we also had an innovation incubator. And just to give you a little bit of insight, so our incubator itself, I studied a lot of incubation models. I mean, there's loads of incubation models. You know, went to see what the guys at Y Combinator was doing, what they're doing in Europe, across the US, Startup Chile, across Africa, in Asia. And eventually I realized that the best incubation that I've ever seen was right in front of me. So we've adopted the best incubation model in the world, and that is the model of pregnancy. There's 7 billion successes. So we've got a 9-month incubation model. We take exactly the 9 months and we just kind of replicate it into how do you take that and apply it to coming up with an idea. And that is what we did. So Cinemo itself, when we started it, our first version of it, we actually used a Go Metro theme for Android that we managed to do, just to see if it would actually work, before we then built our own Android version and we built another version on Mixit. And within the last 9 months, we've got, it's actually over 425,000 users, and we had more than 1.2 million downloads itself, right, of this application that was built by someone right there in our community as well. Another example, quickly, is called Uusi, which is a Finnish word that means new. It's literally poor man's LinkedIn. The first version of this platform as well. We use WordPress just to see if people actually want to or post jobs and will they actually kind of see if they can get a job and connect people. And since doing this for the last 2 years, we've had more than 350,000 registered users on the platform. But more so, 17% of that amount of users actually were able to find jobs. That's close to 50,000 people were able to find work through this platform. But you know what's the greatest thing about this story? The founder of Uusi was a school dropout, an unemployed guy, right? And when he came to me and I had a chat with him, he says, Marlon, you know, he's been unemployed for 8 years and life is tough and he don't know what else to do. And when I told him that, I said, you know what? You've got 8 years experience in being unemployed. That's amazing. But in any other industry, if you have more than 5 years experience, become a consultant. So man, you've got 8 years experience in being unemployed. And I said, why don't you use that to come up with something meaningful? And of course, lo and behold, he took all his frustrations and he came up with Uusi. So what we saw, we began seeing people who had ideas, but they were now actually able to turn those ideas into reality, using the power of WordPress, right? Using the amazing work that all of you guys are doing, and they just kind of build on top of it. And it's making a real difference in their communities. But then, something else happened. A big explosion happened. So yes, Arlabs, it started end of 2007, 2008, on the Cape Flats here in Cape Town. But then we started expanding. All of a sudden, people from outside and other regions saying, can't we also do this as well? So here's just some photos of our team in Nigeria. So we have an Arlabs in Nigeria. We're currently in 21 countries that we expanded to. In Namibia, they just had their graduation this afternoon, actually. We have our team in Sierra Leone. Now, just to quickly show you, to point out, so this guy, he was the first crystal meth dealer in our community. And the guy over there, he was the guy that was wanted for organized crime. The first course I told him that he had to go and do was events management and project management, because he was really good at organizing. No, for real. And he actually passed with a distinction. I had to write a long motivation letter why he should go, and the university had to accept him, and he actually passed very well. Because he had a natural instinct for organizing. So all we do is we constantly use the stuff that our people in our community understand. I mean, it's saying like, who's the best marketer and branding people? It's the gangsters. You know when you go into a gangster's territory. I mean, before Facebook, they were writing on walls already. These guys are good. They're very good. The concept of brand ambassadors, they did it way before. People join the gang and they're willing to die for their brand. So we use these examples to teach people about business principles. We talk about bootstrapping. People have got no clue what bootstrapping means. But we tell them, go and speak to the mothers in the community, the single moms, who raise 4 kids and get them all to go to school. That is bootstrapping. And they learn what are the things that they're learning from these people. And we just apply it into the, you know, the whole business terms. But through all of this, this the team in Tanzania, in Zanzibar, yes, we've got Zanzibar as well. Our team in Botswana. And then also in Asia. I remember when I went to the to visit our team in Asia. The time I got there, when I went to the marketplace, they were selling RLabs t-shirts. Now, we don't sell t-shirts, but we're selling it in the marketplace there in Malaysia. Now, the one thing you know, whenever there's already a knockoff, you know you're doing something good, right? And I must be honest, there was also good themes there, already. But for us, in all of this, I must be honest, it was a journey that I would never have imagined. But the one thing that I just want to encourage you, the three things that you should take away from this is, don't ever underestimate the thing about equipping and empowering people. Yes, you might think, oh, but I can make money there. But by equipping and empowering people will be actually so useful and helpful for you. And also never underestimate the possibilities and the things that people are able to do with the things that you are creating. And above all, always make sure you have fun doing what you're doing. Right? And let us use the skills that we have to actually start breaking the bag wherever our communities are. And I just want to leave you with this quote and then I'll hand back to the MCs. For us it was an impossible journey, but guess what? The journey is only beginning. So ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for listening.
Thank you very much. Do you have any questions?
How can others in the community get involved and help out with your efforts?
Keep on sharing the story of hope, because that's what RLab is about, a movement of hope. I mean, our goal is to make hope contagious. And that's what we're going to do. And I think also for those that, you know, many times, for a lot of people, you can just imagine, most of the people that come through our programs are people that have no formal education. So just for them to have achieved something and accomplished something is a big thing. So for them to show someone, wow, I actually created something, where nobody asked me if they were able to do that. And I think just kind of sharing those kind of stories, and also if you have certain skill sets, I mean, you're more than welcome to come and join, like the guys at WooThemes and the guy from WebAddies, I think Graphic is there, and a lot of the other guys. Just kind of if you're in the, and I think Cape Town or Johannesburg, just to come and share some of your knowledge, you just kind of spend some time. Because for most of the people, just knowing that someone is taking the time out to come and spend time with you is a huge difference. And I think that is one of the good places to start. Just kind of keep on sharing the story.
Are you actually funding your growth?
Are we funding our growth? Very good question. So we bootstrap. We are non-profit, but we also have a for-profit entity. The way we do it is about 40% of our income is donor money that comes from specific projects, and about 60% is self-generated. And we do that through technology stuff. We also invest about $20,000 in every idea that goes to our incubator. So we've done about 20 of those. And we've managed to get about 3x's in the last 2.5 years since we started with that. And so that's often built long-term. And then also we were stunned when people started telling us when we did the social franchising, when we started going to other countries, and people told us, they'll actually pay us to do that. We're like, oh, wow. So we also have a franchise model where people actually pay us to replicate the model.
Where can we actually find your story?
The stories. It's on our website and on our Facebook page, onlabs.org. You'll find a lot of the stories. And also, I mean, you can just kind of message us and there's some way about how you'd like to get involved or want to maybe capture some of the stories. We're quite happy to kind of share some of them as well. There's quite a few video clips on YouTube as well, which most of us, we've made, so you know, you might see our hands going like that.
Hi, how easy is it to take this sort of model into prisons, or do you have that in store for the future?
Now we've looked into prisons. The big challenge, of course, is there's a lot of challenges around other things in the prison. Although for those who don't know, airtime is a big currency in prisons at the moment. But for us at the moment, it's more a matter of once people come out of it, how can we actually serve? Because many of them struggle to find themselves back into society. Therefore, they'd rather go back. But of my own personal story, my brother was just released from prison. So hence was one of the reasons why I was really passionate about it. He was involved in gangs and drugs. So the big thing is it's really about preventing first that people won't go and venture into that first. But just because of some of the kind of the constraints in our prison, we haven't thought about doing this inside of prisons. However, we are working with a lot of juvenile facilities where people haven't done serious crimes. We'll be going and we do training with them, with some of these groups as well, on an ongoing basis.
Awesome. Cool. Thank you very much. Great stuff.
Thank you, Marlon. If you want to ask more questions, hit up Marlon on Twitter, @MarlonParker.